Well, you're representing the building industry, so let's just pretend for a moment that I'm about to sign a contract to construct an office complex somewhere in Australia, and I'm trying to hire a workforce. I look at this and I say to myself, well, the people who are going to suffer if this happens is a worker who's not got as much experience is presumably not going to be hired, because if I'm the boss and I have to pay that worker the same as what I'm paying someone who's been on the tools for 20 years, is highly regarded in the industry in that particular field, why would I hire someone who's not as qualified as that and pay them? So that person's not going to get a job, right?
You're dead right. The other consequence is that those workers who do have excellent skills, lots of experience, lots of familiarity with particular types of work, or has got a long-standing relationship with their employer, they're going to be much less likely to get a pay rise from their boss, simply because their boss might be concerned about the application of this policy and what it might mean for them. So it's an attack on both ends. It's an attack on experienced workers. It's an attack on workers' right to say, I'm worth more than the guy next to me or the girl next to me. I deserve to be paid more. It's going to stop that. And at the same time, it's going to make it harder for young people coming into the industry. Building and construction is already an industry that where we have very, very well-paid jobs. We've got one of the highest rates of full-time employment of any industry sector in the country. One of our biggest problems, aside from a tight labour market, is the future skills needs for our industry. We're going to need at least 400,000 more people in our industry over the next 5 years. And a policy like this is simply going to make it harder to fill those needs. And, of course, all of this combines to drive up the cost of construction, introduce uncertainty into the building and construction industry, which couldn't come at a worst possible time.
I don't want to be overly alarmist, but I mean, you know, just go onto the worksite for a start and think about the problems that it would cause in the tea room with people having arguments about why am I being paid a certain amount of money and you're getting the same amount and I've got 10 years more experience than you. And that doesn't make for a very jovial workplace, does it?
No, exactly right. And I mean, look, at the end of the day, workplace laws in Australia have always fundamentally been about creating a minimum safety net of terms and conditions, but then allowing people the freedom to negotiate up, to have arrangements that suit particular employment relationships, and to get paid and recognised for the work that they're doing and the experience that they have. Really, the laws are all about allowing people to get up and have a go and have a fair crack and to basically put in a hard day's work and be rewarded for your effort. This policy is completely inconsistent with all of those long-held concepts that underpin our workplace relations system. I mean, there's a real concern not only in terms of, you know, the impact on general workforce needs, but a real attack here on basic Australian values. I mean, this is a pretty un-Australian approach and really does go to undermine a lot of the things I think most Australian workers hold dear.
Un-Australian's a good way to put it. Shaun, just finally, let's go to Tony Burke. He was asked today about these changes, potential changes. He said, this is a quote, the government's conversation is about closing loopholes and the business conversation today has been plain loopy. ACTU boss Sally McManus said the campaign is crazy and bizarre. Can I get your reaction to those two quotes?
Well, if standing up for small business, standing up for fairness in workplaces, and standing up for subbies and independent tradies in the building and construction industry is loopy, guilty as charged.